Good morning. Good morning, ladies. I am so blessed to be with you all this morning. Did you all enjoy last night? Are you all awake this morning? Because I know y'all were turning it up last night and dropping it and wobbling it and all that kind of stuff. Are you awake? Okay, I need you to be awake. If we're going to be fearless, we need to be awake. If we're going to be fearless, we need to be transparent and awake. Right? This morning, I need you to open your hearts, open your minds, open your spirits to what God has to say. You cannot be fearless, ladies. It's not going to work. You can put on the t-shirt, but it's not going to work if you are standing behind a mask. A mask of self-deception. A mask where you hide your emotions. A mask where you pretend to be something that you're not. A mask where you pretend to be strong when you are weak. A mask where you act like you haven't been hurt, but you have. You won't be fearless standing behind the mask. Are we ready to be open, transparent, and fearless this morning? Y'all ready up there? Because I don't hear any clap. Okay. All right, I got you. Okay. So, in the spirit of transparency, I'm going to tell you my earliest memory of being rejected. It's actually not that deep, but I'm gonna tell you. So I'm in elementary school, and I am not very athletic. You may not be able to, but I am scared of the ball. Anybody scared of the ball? You're just scared of the ball. Don't throw the ball, because I'll be like, and I'm scared of the ball. So everybody in elementary school knew that I was scared of the ball. Everybody in middle school and high school knew I was scared of the ball. I was just scared of the ball. I'm scared of the ball today. So think back to when you're going out to recess and the teacher or whomever splits everybody up into teams. And they pick the team leaders to choose who's on the team. Are y'all feeling me? Okay, I'm not that old. And so they would pick, like, the best people to be the team leaders, and then they would start choosing people from off the wall, and they would choose, you know, Kim, James, Bashada, LaShonda, Jeff, and I'm still on the wall. In fact, it would be me and Brent. And Brent was a nice little fellow, but you know, he had some challenges. He had the glasses, the Beatles haircut, little portly little fellow. And he and I were on the wall. And it was funny because Brent didn't have any friends. And wherever Brent is today, God loves you, Brent. He was nice. But I had friends. In fact, the guy who was almost always the team leader, Joe, he had passed me one of those little letters. You know the letters, will you be my girlfriend, check yes or no? But letter notwithstanding, he wasn't about to sacrifice his kickball game by putting me on the team. I was rejected. I felt rejected. Anybody ever felt rejected? I know we're all feeling warm and fuzzy and cuddly here today, and I'm feeling so accepted. Thank you, Grace Family Church, for inviting me back. Thank you, Kristen. I had the pleasure of working with Kristen and the women's ministry team for a number of years, and it was awesome. They've kicked it up a notch since I left, I see. And Miss Debbie and everybody, so I'm so grateful for being here. But we feel wonderful and accepted right now in the moment. But everybody has felt rejected. You may be in a season of rejection right now. I've been there. And if you haven't felt like you've been rejected, you will be. It's coming. I hate to tell y'all. It's coming. Rejection is a part of life. In fact, it's a thing now to study rejection. You have to excuse me because I've been getting my master's degree on the side. So I'm going through all these courses, and rejection is being heavily studied. Because social scientists are just now beginning to see how important, how crucial rejection is to how we live our lives. Even if we're not feeling rejected right now, chances are you've built up walls because you were rejected before. You approach situations timidly because you felt like you were the last one standing on that wall. They've even discovered that when someone is rejected, the parts of their brain that are activated are the same parts of the brain that are activated when you feel physical pain. So that a broken heart can elicit the same brain activity as a broken arm. And they say if you take a Tylenol, they found that it eases the feeling of rejection. It's a thing now. They've even done studies that have revealed that babies feel rejection. As their brains are developing, a baby whose mother or caregiver does not respond to their cries routinely, or a baby who plays or tries to, you do the little baby stuff. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I don't have a baby, but I've seen babies. And they do that. When they start doing that and people don't respond back, the baby develops an avoidant tendency to where they begin to avoid because the pain of rejection is real. So if the baby experiences that, and then the mother comes back in, the baby will avoid the mother or the person who did that. We'll start playing with these little toys instead of trying to engage with that person. The baby is building up walls. So I want to tell you that if you want to be fearless, you've got to be ready to be rejected. You got to be ready for it because you may not get the job. Anybody never, you didn't get the job. You may not get the man. Or perhaps you got the man, but he left you for somebody else. Rejection. not have been the favored child. I heard a yes out there, rejection. You may have felt rejected by the friends that you had or the people that you wanted to be your friend. You may have felt rejected by your church. Some of you may have even felt rejected by God. He hasn't answered your prayers. Where is God? I know some of y'all are, it's the beginning of the year, still January, so you just came off that Daniel fast, that 21 day. Anybody ever? I did the Daniel, y'all, not this year. But I have done it before, and you know, you get up and, ooh, you got something on your heart and on your mind. You've heard all these miracles that were performed after the Daniel fast. I mean, people have gotten pregnant and had babies who have been trying for years. But then the Daniel fast. Girl, I'm pregnant. She didn't even have a uterus. Wow, how did that happen? No fallopian tubes. Pregnancy, here. Daniel fast, Daniel fast, Daniel fast. Finances are repaired with the Daniel fast. And you get on that Daniel fast, you get up, girl, you boil your water, you put your little oats in it, and you eat that, and you got your popcorn with no seasoning on it. That's your snack. That's the... And your 21 days is up, and you're like, God, everybody else was chosen. Heather got chosen for a big breakthrough, a big blessing. Laura was chosen, and you are standing on the wall. Rejected. Rejection can take very big extremes. You can be so rejected that you begin to act out aggressively, overly aggressively, like you're gonna see me. You will see me. You know, I'm not gonna be rejected again. You will pay attention to me. But this becomes serious because remember the school shootings. Columbine. Those people were rejected. On the other extreme, you have the people who are rejected and they turn inward and feel so isolated. That they never speak up. They never make connections. Some of them become suicidal. Anybody in the room, not to raise your hand, but ever felt that way? Because you were rejected. Then there are those of us who are in the middle. And rejection begins to shape our lives in ways that we don't even pay attention. We stop dreaming because we don't want to be rejected. We don't want God to not answer our dreams. We stop engaging. We stop living purposefully. We begin to internalize other people's rejections. We begin to let rejection define who we are. Oh, she said I wasn't good enough. Oh, they said I wasn't qualified. Rejection. The truth is that we have all been rejected. And we have stood in the place of the rejecter. Sometimes God calls us to do that. But we've got to know, if we're going to be fearless, how to handle rejection. Because you can't walk out of here and be fearless unless you can stand in front of rejection. Stand right in the face of rejection and say, you know what? I ain't scared of you. Amen. So I'm going to tell you this morning how you can handle rejection. And you know what, Kristen? I didn't even ask you what time. I'm supposed to be done, but do something. Yeah. Say, do like that. Okay. How are we going to handle this thing called rejection? Because you know what? You're going to have to be ready for rejection. Don't let rejection slip up on you. First thing that you've got to do to be ready for rejection is, number one, this. You've got to know your worth and your position in Christ. Know your worth, know your position in Christ. Know that you are valuable for the simple reason that God created you in his image for a purpose to be lived out on this earth. If you don't know that, then when people reject you, you will accept their definition of who you are. You gotta already know. Say, I already know. Some of y'all lied because you don't know. But just say it. Just keep saying, I already know who I am. I already know. I know that I'm the head and not the tail. I know that I'm above and not beneath. I know that I am beautiful and wonderful and created in the image of Christ. I already know. Jesus Christ was the ultimate reject. Y'all are quiet this morning. Did y'all get y'all espresso that Lisa was talking about last night with the amaretto and the fig leaves and the mint and the cinnamon, caramel, whipped cream on the top? Y'all didn't get that? Okay. Because y'all need to, yeah. Jesus was the ultimate reject because you know what happened? People, the chosen people of God, were expecting the Messiah to come as a political savior. They were expecting the Messiah to come and overthrow the Romans and show them that we are God's people and we are supposed to be in authority. But he didn't come like that. He came with some carpentry tools from a little city called Nazareth with a calm demeanor talking about the Spirit. Didn't go over well with the leaders of the church. Can you imagine, even today, the Messiah coming from Apopka? Strolling up in here from Ocala talking about, I'm the savior of the world. No offense to anybody from Apopka and Ocala, those are great cities. I'm just trying to make a point here. That he didn't come like they thought he would. And so they looked at him and they said, who is this man? Can you imagine them even interviewing Jesus? Oh, so you're the Messiah. He says he's the Messiah. So have you been in any battles perhaps with the Romans? Have you won? I performed a couple miracles. Changed some water into wine back at Cana. Did y'all hear about that? Or I don't think he's the one. They disqualified Jesus and told him he was not the Messiah, told him he was not created to do the very thing that God called him to do. You can't let rejectors define you. Can you imagine what would have happened if Jesus walked out and said, oh, well, maybe I'm not. Okay, well, maybe I can make some pews or something, get my tools together. No, that's not what Jesus did. There's a verse, Psalms 1 and 18, 22, tells us, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is talking about Jesus. It's talking about what would happen to him. He was the stone and the builders were the leaders of the church. And he became the chief cornerstone, meaning that he was the stone on which the church rested. How did that happen? It happened because Jesus knew his worth and he knew his position despite what everybody else was saying. It happened because when they rejected him, Jesus said, okay, you don't want me? Okay. He wouldn't got him some more stones. He said, come on, James, Peter, John, y'all, come on, take up your cross and follow me. And he went out and he began to do what God told him to do, what he was sent to do, what the Father and he and the Holy Spirit had agreed to do all along. So the rejection did not define him, it simply redirected him. It redirected. But see, he was going to move forward and keep going on the path to his destiny. Just a little different route. Okay, y'all don't want me? Let me just go. And kept moving forward. In fact, today, we are living stones. We are part of the stones of the church. In 1 Peter 2, 4 through 6, it says, you are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. That's us. What's more, you are holy priests. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God, as the scriptures say. I am placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem, chosen for great honor, and anyone who trusts in him, anyone, will never be disgraced. Yeah, clap for the word. Will never be disgraced, and some versions say, will never be put to shame. He was rejected. You will be rejected. You have been rejected, yet you are a living stone. In the temple that Jesus Christ has built, resting, you rest on the great cornerstone, who is our Lord and Savior. Amen. So that's the first thing. You've got to know your worth. Say it again. I already know. Know your position. Number two, you've got to focus on praising God rather than pleasing men. Okay, that's getting a hand clap already. Somebody was feeling that. Now, Jesus was the ultimate reject. And in my opinion, the second biggest reject in the word is my girl Leah. Some of y'all don't know her. Leah, in the book of Genesis, poor thing. Okay, let me tell y'all a little bit about Leah. Leah was the daughter of Laban. She had a sister named Rachel. And then there was Jacob, you know, the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the founders of the church, the forefathers and all of that. So Jacob was looking for a wife. He happens upon Rachel. She's beautiful. The Bible says her eyes sparkled. She was all of that. She was fine. And he wanted to marry her. And so he goes to her father and he says, hey, can I marry your daughter? The father says, yeah, sure. Why not? Okay, you're Jacob. You're the man. So he says, he gives Jacob permission to marry Rachel. Well, on the night that they're going to consummate this thing, because that's how you sealed the marriage in those days, Laban slips Leah in there because Leah was older than Rachel. And it would be a disgrace for the younger daughter to be married before the older. So when I said he slips her in there, he sent her to Jacob's tent. And Jacob winds up sleeping with Leah when he thinks he's sleeping with Rachel to consummate the marriage. Now, obviously, the lighting was bad. obviously. So he sleeps with her. The morning light comes. He's like, what is going on? I thought this was Rachel. And the father was like, yeah, but you had to marry her first. So then he also lets him marry Rachel. But what has happened here is that Leah is now in a loveless marriage. She is with somebody who does not want her. Anybody ever been there? She's in a relationship with a man who would rather be with somebody else. So God does a little something here. He sees her in Genesis 29 and 31. And it says, when the Lord saw that Leah was unloved, she was unloved. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. He enabled her to have children, but Rachel could not conceive. So God smiled on her, gave her a little something so she could feel good about herself. So what then happens? Leah feels a little special. She begins to birth these babies, which were good in those days. Well, they're good now. What am I talking about? They're good now. Babies are good. They're yes. Thank you for populating the earth, ladies. I don't have any yet, so I'm just going to remove from the situation. But yeah, so they're good. They were really good in terms of the lineage, carrying on the lineage, especially sons back in those days. So she begins to have these sons for Jacob. And Leah believes that this is going to endear her to her husband and make him love her. And we can see this by the way she named the babies. Back then, you know, the names had meaning and all of that. And so she names the first son Reuben. And Reuben means see a son. That word means see a son. So it was like she had Reuben and she goes up to Jacob and she says, see, I gave you a son. And Jacob said, okay, good, yes, firstborn son. Rachel? Leah, she goes back, okay. I can conceive. God has blessed me. And she has another son. And this son she calls Simeon. And Simeon means God hears. God hears me. God hears me. He's giving me more sons. Jacob, God hears. Jacob, good, yes, I got two big, strong, strapping boys. Thank you. Okay. He goes on about his way. Because the word, if you look at this story in context, if you read Genesis 29, he just never really got into Leah. The Bible says her eyes were dull. Didn't have it quite going on like her sister. She had another baby. She's like, okay. Third baby comes out. It's a boy too. His name is Levi, which means attached or connected. A third son. Surely Jacob will become attached to me now. Surely we will be connected as husband and wife. No. I mean, we can assume that he respected her as the mother of his kids and took care of her, but it was clear who the love of his life was. And then she has a fourth son. And we can see that there's a shift. Because this son, she names Judah. And Judah means praise God. This fourth son, she's praise God. Thank you, Lord. This son, she's not connecting to her relationship to Jacob. Now she's praising God for all that he has given her. She begins to understand, but wait a minute. He may not love me. He may never love me. But God has given me four strong, strapping boys who love their mother unconditionally. He created a circle of acceptance for her, where before there was none. Now, finally, Leah is experiencing the love that she never had before. Because you know those boys thought their mama was the cream of the crop. Any mothers in the house? And I suspect that Leah was like, okay, I don't know what Jacob's going to do. Go with Rachel. Her eyes are sparkling. But I got some kids to take care of who love me and are depending on me. She turned her focus to praising God, where before she was giving away something special that God had given her to please a man. Anybody ever done that? You ever gave away something special that God gave you? You ever gave away your heart to please somebody and they didn't appreciate it? Anybody ever given away your time? Has anybody ever given away yourself to someone who still didn't love you or didn't appreciate you, didn't get into you? Is there somebody who's working for a boss and you're working hard? You made your quota. You stayed working late at night. You did all that you could. But still, you weren't the cream of the crop. That's how you feel, rejected. Well, I'm here to tell you that God wants you to turn your focus to him, because that's who you really work for. The third thing you need to do, 1, 2, 3. The first thing is know your worth and your position in Christ. The second thing is praise God and not man. Number 3, get you ready for rejection. You're going to need to press beyond your rejectors to receive your blessing. And I mean, you're really going to have to press. You're going to have to press beyond the people who have said you're not good enough, beyond the people who have said, I really don't like her. You're going to have to press. There's a familiar story in the Word that talks about a woman who had to press. It was a woman with the issue of blood. The woman with the issue of blood can be found in Luke 8, thereabouts, and some of the other gospels as well. But the woman with the issue of blood, she had this blood issue where she was hemorrhaging for 12 years. She had a long, 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 long cycle. Don't you hate that? It was long, y'all. And she had gone to all these doctors for a cure, and nobody could cure her. Nobody knew what to do with her. She had spent up all this money trying to be healed. Well, the thing about it is, it wasn't just the physical sickness that was plaguing her. You see, because in those days, if you were on your cycle or if you were hemorrhaging, you were considered to be unclean. So you couldn't touch people and touch stuff because anything you touch would be considered unclean. So can you imagine the isolation that she experienced? Can you imagine the looks that she experienced when she went out? People, that's the woman with the issue. She didn't have a name, y'all. Or she had a name, but it wasn't in the Bible. I'm sure she had a name. Can you imagine the rejection that she felt? This was open. Everybody knew what she was going through. But then one day, she finds out that Jesus is coming to town. And by this time, y'all, Jesus had performed a few more miracles, and he was the man now. I don't know what the leaders of the church were saying. They were still trying to hate on him and stuff, but he was like, you know what? We got my disciples. We're doing some stuff. People are being healed. And so she had heard about all these miracles that Jesus performed. And she heard that he was coming across the sea to Galilee. Everybody was like, oh, Jesus coming, that miracle-working Jesus, the one who's supposed to be the Messiah, he's coming, he's coming, he's coming. And I imagine that she heard about this. And maybe she wished that she could get a private appointment with Jesus so she could just, you know, go behind the scenes. But of course, that wasn't possible. The only way that she could get to this master who could heal her was to do it openly. She would have to go out in public, press her way around the people who knew what was her issue. Press her way to Jesus. Anybody ever been in a situation where everybody knew what was your issue? Everybody knew what you had done. Your face was on the news. They read it about it in the paper. Child, please. Everybody in the small group has already called each other and talked about it. Not that they do that in the small groups here. I'm just, you know. But it's open. It's out. And so in order to get to the healer, she has to press through the rejection of everybody looking looking at her, everybody talking about her. She has to press through, press her way. And I imagine, you know, people, is that the woman with the issue? But just like Jesus, she had to step aside but keep on going. Going to reach her destiny, which was the healer. And when she got there, when she got to Jesus, when she pressed her way through the crowds, she grabbed the hem of his garment. And the power that came from his being healed her. And Jesus looked around. In Luke 8:46, it says, but Jesus said to the disciples and all those who were around him, someone touched me because I was aware that power to heal had gone out of me. When the woman saw that she had not escaped notice, she came up trembling and fell down before him. She declared in the presence of all the people the reason why she had touched him and how she had been immediately healed. In front of all the people who had rejected her, she said, yes, it was me. It was me, Master. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. If you want to be fearless, if you want to reach your destiny, if you want to accomplish your goal, you're going to have to get desperate. Desperate for the things of God. Just like the woman. You're going to have to press in desperation to reach God, in desperation to get all that he has for you. You're going to have to look beyond what people are saying. You're going to have to look beyond what people are thinking. You're going to have to look beyond what you think people might be thinking about you. You're going to have to stare that rejection in the face and say, I ain't scared of you. Get on out of my way. I've got to get. Y'all got to excuse me. I've been doing some acting, so I'm trying to, I got to get. In your life. That's the only way that you're going to be fearless, ladies. You've got to press your way beyond the rejectors. You've got to already know who you are. You've got to say, I am more than a conqueror. Say that right now, I am more than a conqueror. Say, I am beautifully and wonderfully made. Say, I already know that I'm qualified. I already know who I am. And you can't define me. You will not define me because you don't like my shoes. You will not define me because you don't like what I've got on. You will not define me because you don't like the way that I talk. You will not define me because I don't fit into your mold. I am a conqueror. I am fearless. And I'm pressing my way. Oh, you don't want me. Okay. You're not the one. Okay. I'm pressing my way. Somebody needs to press in here this morning. Somebody needs to press her way. And I'm going to ask you to press your way right on up here to this altar. Oh, see, you know I was going to do that. You thought you was going to. Yeah. I want to ask you to press your way. If this word spoke to you, if you know that you built up walls, that you've lived life timidly, avoiding rejection, that you've been afraid to even ask God for your deepest desires and dreams to be fulfilled because you didn't know if he was going to do it. If you haven't been as desperate for the things of God as you have been eager to please man, if you don't know your worth, your value, if it's hard for you to press, to stare down rejection and say, oh, this is just redirection, but I'm still on my path. I need you to come up here. I need you to press your way. I need you to press your way beyond the people sitting beside you. I need you to press your way beyond the video. I need you to press your way. Come on, press your way, ladies. You better press. You better press. Press your way. Press. Press. Your rejectors will not define you. Your rejectors will not tell you that you're disqualified. You are worthy. You are precious. God loves you. He honors you. Press. I see some still pressing. Press your way. Press your way. This is what this is about. You've got to press your way. You've got to be fearless, desperate. Oh, I'm desperate. These are some desperate women right now. But desperate in a good way. Desperate for the things of God. Desperate to be all that he has called you to be. Press. Press. I need every woman who's sitting down to be in prayer right now. Be in prayer right now. Pray. God is doing a mighty work. He's doing a mighty work. Pray. We're pressing our way. We're pressing our way. We're pressing our way. We're forgetting those things that are behind. And we're pressing forward. We're pressing forward to the prize of the high calling that is Christ Jesus. Amen. Oh, I see just a few more pressing. Just a few more pressing. Ladies in your seats, stretch your hands out toward these women. Toward these women, because we know that God has not rejected them. We know that God loves them. Oh, Father, we come to you right now. Humbly, Lord God. Humbly, Lord God. At your throne, Lord. We bow down in our spirits at your throne. Lord God, you hear the cries of your women, Lord God. You hear the pain in their heart. You know the details of their rejection, oh God. You know what you have called them to be, Lord. And you know the walls that are blocking them, Lord God. You know the obstacles that are in their way. But we cast those things aside right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, no job, no employer, no man, no parent, no rejecting parent. action will stop them, will make them feel unworthy any longer in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, we declare that we are going to be fearless for you. Lord God, we're going to stand those rejectors in the face, and we're going to say we're not scared of you anymore. We are living stones, high priestesses that you have created to be a part of your holy temple, Lord God. And just as Jesus was rejected, but was also resurrected, we declare right now, Lord God, that the rejections that we have felt, the pains that we have felt, Lord God, will be our resurrection, Lord God. We rise up. Lord God, that those pains, Lord God, have only made us stronger in you, have only made us more diligent in you, that they will only make us more desperate for you, Lord God. So we rise up right now in the name of Jesus. We declare, Lord God, that we are your women, that we are your living stones, and that you accept us and love us unconditionally, Lord God. Lay every pain, Lord God. We lay those pains down, Lord God, at your feet, because we know that you care for us, Lord God, and we're going to be ready. We're going to be ready, Lord God, when someone tries to reject us again. When those things come, Lord God, that hurt us again, we're going to be ready, because we know who we are in you. We know, Lord God, that we are your children, that we are children of the Most High King. So we thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to know who we are by knowing you. Lord God, we declare right now that our focus is on you, is on praising you. Hallelujah to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah to your name, Holy God. Hallelujah to your name, Jesus. You are worthy. You are the great I am. Lord God, you are our provider. You are our protector. You are our healer, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord God, we're pressing our way. We're pressing our way. We're pressing our way. We're pressing our way, Lord God. It may not happen instantly, Lord God, but we started the process of pressing our way, pressing our way, pressing our way, Lord God, to reach you. Pressing our way to get to you, Lord God. Pressing our way to your healing. Pressing our way to your blessings. Pressing our way, Lord God, to know you. To be more and more and more like you, Lord God, where we are weak. You are strong, Lord God. And Lord God, the tears that are being shed right now, Lord God, we offer those tears to you. We offer our tears to you, Lord God, like the woman who wiped your feet, Lord God. We offer our tears to you, Heavenly Father. We lay them down, Lord God, at your feet. And we offer them as a sacrifice. We give that pain over to you, Lord Jesus. Because you are the one who can heal our broken hearts, can heal our discouraged hearts, can heal, Lord God, everything that we felt forsaken in, Lord God. You can redeem us. So we thank you, Jesus. This morning, Lord God, for transformation. We thank you, Lord God, for honoring your word in us, Lord God. We praise you right now in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' precious name, Lord God, we say hallelujah and amen.